Hare Krishna. So this morning is a beautiful verse where the representatives of the Supreme Lord from Vaikuntha, they have come to personally escort Dhruva Maharaj back to Godhead. And in this verse, they are informing him of his mission, of their mission. That now, Parshadav iha sampraptav, that you have attained the position of being a Parshad, of an associate of the Lord. Who is that Lord? Tasya akhila jagat, the jagat dhatu, one who is the sustainer of the whole world, and that Lord who is the carrier of the sharanga. And to that Lord, netum tvam, now to take him, to take you to his abode, netu is to take, bhagvat padam, his abode, we have come here. So this, we could say, is the perfection of the aspiration of a devotee, that the Lord and his associates themselves, the Lord's associates come personally to escort the devotee. And this is a privilege that is accorded to the rarest of special souls. Everybody dies. Now, the challenge of human life is to die in such a way that we don't have to die again. That this, in this life, death we can't avoid. But even this life, or by the end of this life, we have developed enough love for the eternal, for God, then there is nothing to get us back into this world. And then we will attain the eternal world. So, that the challenge is that how do we develop that much love for Krishna during the journey of this life? And we have been discussing yesterday and today now that how do we go back to Godhead. Yesterday I talked about first desire. Does Godhead really exist? First we have to have that philosophically reasoned conviction. Then by association we create the desire. And then by purification the desire becomes stabilized. So I talked about RAP yesterday. And today overall I am talking about the DEP. Desire, eligibility and process. So today we will be talking about eligibility. And here, Prahlad is, Dhruva has become so eligible.
So what was the R for again?
R was for reasoning.
Reasoning.
Yeah. So, now Dhruva has become so eligible that personally the Lord's associates have come to take him back, to escort him back. So, if you consider the metaphor of, say, immigration or emigration, depending we are immigrating to a country or emigrating from a country, whichever way. So normally, how it is that, say with respect to first world country like say Australia or America or Canada, New Zealand, many people from third world or less developed countries want to come here. Now when they want to come, they make an application. Now depending on, I was just in New Zealand a few months ago, there's one devotee doctor, he told me that he applied from India. And when he applied, within like 3 days, the New Zealand embassy personally called him and told him that we'll give this benefit, this benefit, this benefit, please come here. So that was almost like maybe 30-40 years ago. So at that time, you could say that the government there needed qualified doctors, and that's why they were personally calling. Now the situation has changed and people want to immigrate and they keep applying, especially in America. You know, there are a lot of Indians who are on H-1B visa, they are work visa, and it's just not getting, they are not getting any permanent residency. So there's a huge upsurge in Indians from there immigrating to Canada. In fact, there are many devotees who do international travel every day. They live in Canada and they work in America. So they keep traveling. So for most people in most situations, immigration to another country is quite difficult. And if a country itself sends its representatives to come, please come to our country, then that means that person is very specially qualified. So if you consider, they say there can be two extremes. Say if somebody is a big underworld don, a very great criminal, and that person is going from place A to place B, then if that person is on their own, they will have probably their bodyguards. If that person is under arrest, then there will be police with them. Similarly, if the head of state, the prime minister is traveling, then again the prime minister will have bodyguards, the prime minister will have associates. So we could say these are two extremes. You know, if somebody is a very degraded person who has done horribly wrong activities, then when they depart from the world, at that time there will be yamdutas who will come to escort them. And for those who are extremely pure devotees, for them Vishnutas will come. So like that, for hardcore criminals and for very big shots, there will be escorts. So most of us, when we travel unescorted. So like that, at the end of our lives also, most of us, we go unescorted. So now, even within this, there are degrees. That it is said that those who are higher beings, they manifest at our level based on how pleased they are with us. So for example, if a great soul departs from the world, and even if they are going back to the spiritual world, on most occasions, there is nothing miraculous that is seen at this level. Generally, if we consider a parallel, that when in the Vedic tradition, fire sacrifices, yajñas would be performed. At that time, the yajñas would have different markers of success. First marker is that if somebody is able to just perform the yajña without any interruption or contamination, that itself is a success. The fire sacrifice has been done, and then finally the oblations are made into the fire and the smoke rises up. And it's understood that because the sacrifice was performed properly and it was completed, the devatas come in an invisible form and accept the offering. If the sacrifice is done very well, if the sponsor of the sacrifice, the yajaman, is a very special person, then the devatas appear visibly. But if the yajaman is extremely special, then not only the devatas, but the param devatas. That param devata Vishnu himself appears. So Vishnu appearing in a sacrificial ceremony is very, very rare. And the devatas appearing is rare. So if we consider in the same canto, we will have later Prithu Maharaj's pastime. So Prithu Maharaj wants to do 100 yajñas, and he completes 99, and then when he is to do the 100, Indra keeps interrupting repeatedly. And finally, at the request of Brahma, Prithu has been ready to punish Indra, abstains. And when he abstains from both doing the 100th yajna and as well as punishing Indra, now you could say Indra was wrong and Brahma is and Prithu is right. No, Prithu was pious and with his resources performing a yajna. Indra was insecure that Prithu will take my position. So that insecurity is Indra's problem, not Prithu's problem. But you know, there is right, and there is right beyond right. Right beyond right means what? Technically speaking, this is right and this is wrong. But sometimes arguing what is right and what is wrong can itself become such an endless discussion that maybe some people just have to rise above the issue. The right beyond right is, okay, I am right and you are wrong in this issue, but this is not that big an issue that I want to keep fighting on this. I have a bigger purpose. So the right beyond right is to not let the right action come in the way of the right purpose. Normally we would say that the right action will lead to the right purpose. Say for example, if we are having some philosophical discussion, or if there is somebody giving a class, and then somebody makes a point which is apparently, say if the speaker makes a point which is philosophically objectionable. Now somebody in the audience may feel, no, this is a wrong point, it should not be spoken. Now okay, it depends on what kind of point it is. Sometimes the audience may be a very responsible person, they may feel, okay, you know, this point, if it's spoken, the audience will get a misconception and that will be bad. Yes, that's bad. But sometimes in life, we don't have a choice between good and bad. The only choice is between bad and worse. So for example, now, if in a class, say between a speaker and the member of the audience, there starts becoming argument and it turns nasty. Then most people would have forgotten the wrong philosophical point, but they will not forget the nasty confrontation. And that will send more unpleasant vibes than the wrong point that might be spoken. Even if it is a wrong point, is people's ideas about Krishna consciousness are not formed just by one point that they hear somewhere. If that point makes sense, they will have it. But if they will clarify if it's an important point, so they can learn from other sources. So the point I'm making is that Pruthu, he didn't try to be right, he tried to be right beyond right. That means when the right action came in the way of the right purpose, then he put the right action. If somebody is speaking wrong, it's okay, it's right to contradict them, to point out they're wrong. But then if that's going to cause greater alienation, don't do that. So why I'm making this point is, by this, he could not perform the 100th yajna, but Vishnu was so pleased that Vishnu appeared after that. Vishnu had not appeared after the 99 yajnas he had performed, but when he let go, that's when Vishnu appeared. And just as Vishnu's appearance is very special, similarly, here, Vishnu's appearance in the yajna is very special. So similarly, Vishnu's appearance in the fire, at the time of a departure of a person, that is very special. And it's the way this is described, Vishnu's appeared, and they did not just appear to the perception of Dhruva. They appeared to human perception. And we will see later it is described that the sages who were observing, they started all, you know, worshipping Dhruva also, saying that it's glorious, but Dhruva did not accept the worship, rather Dhruva sought their blessings, that I am going on this momentous journey back to Godhead. So how did Dhruva become so eligible that the government sends its representatives, please come and immigrate to our country. So like from the Vaikuntha, the Vishnudutas are coming. So it's a very, very special situation. So if we consider what did Dhruva do? Now, Dhruva Maharaj, if you look at his life, it had its ups and downs. It was not that he was a pure devotee from birth. Now, you could look at it from a transcendental perspective and you say that every soul in the Bhagavatam is special. And we could say they are just pure devotees and they are doing a leela over here. That's okay, that's one way of looking at it. But if you want to learn some lessons for our life, treating everyone as transcendental pure devotees, simply doing a leela, doesn't teach us much lessons. So if you look at it from the perspective of the evolution of Dhruva Maharaj, so what happened? I'll talk about the evolution specifically in tomorrow's class when I talk about the process. But today I'll just go over the thing and come to the conclusion. So Dhruva Maharaj, he was born in a pious family, but from piety to spirituality, that journey happened because of adversity. When his stepmother insulted him and his father neglected him, that's when he went and he did, as Prabhupada says in the purport, he performed intense austerities. That's how he saw Vishnu. Now, and it was great benediction, and at that time he lost the desire to gain a kingdom bigger than his father's. But still, Vishnu gave him that kingdom. And then after that, he was living virtuously, but when his brother was killed by the Yakshas, again he lost his temper. And he overreacted. He started, for the action of one Yaksha, he started slaughtering many, many Yakshas. And again, Manu had to intervene. And then he abstained from that violence. So you may say, if he's a pure devotee, how did he get overcome by anger? That is what, that process of how, what pure devotion means. And how it is not such a lofty idol that's unattainable. We'll talk about that again in tomorrow's class. But the point is that throughout, not tomorrow, Sunday's class, so throughout, basically, he remained persistent in the practice of bhakti. And by that persistent practice of bhakti, although there were distractions, but he came back on course after the distractions. And he was now, by the time when death came, he was ready. He was detached from the world. His focus was only on the Lord. Oh Lord, wherever you want to take me, I'm ready to go. So when he was detached from the world and from his plans of what all he wants to do in the world, the Lord sent his devotee. So we could now turn this question. So basically, it was his lifetime of devotion, which we could say was his eligibility. Now there is a this is a difference in concept, not so much necessarily in language. So there is, you could say, there is qualification and there is eligibility. Now, the two words, they can broadly be said to mean the same thing, but here we will use the two words in slightly different sense. See, eligibility means that, okay, you are eligible for this, that, okay, you can participate in this. But qualified means that you can enter into this. So for example, if there is a competitive exam for entering into a particular university. So now, if it's a postgraduate course, then the eligibility itself is that you have to have a graduation degree. If you don't have graduation, you can't get into it only. But just graduation alone is not the qualification. So eligibility means that allows you to participate. But qualification means what you get inside, what gets you inside. You can get into the arena, get into the competition, but to get entry, that's a further thing. So what we can get is, by our endeavors, is eligibility. We never get qualification. So the way you could summarize this is that we are always unqualified, but we are never disqualified. Because always unqualified means nobody can claim that I am such a pure devotee, Krishna, you have to take me to Godhead now. Mm-hmm. Bhakti Siddhanta Thakur would say that you cannot gate crash into the kingdom of God. Sometimes if the gate is closed, some people might come in a big truck and they just bang through, break the door down and charge inside. He says we cannot do like that. It's interesting, in the Bhagavatam, the 8th canto, we will see that apparently Durvasa Muni gate crashes into the kingdom of God. That means when he is being chased by Sudarshan Chakra, he first goes to Brahma, then he goes to Shiva, and then he even goes to Vishnu. So how is he able to reach Vishnu and Vaikuntha? See, the point over there is, Vaikuntha is not just a geographical area. Of course, it is a place, but it is not just a place. It is also a level of consciousness. And the level of consciousness that takes us there is the consciousness of absorption in service to the Lord. Unless we have the desire to serve the Lord, even if we get there, we are not actually there in terms of consciousness. And so that's why he got to see Vishnu, he reached Vishnu, but his concern was, save me from Sudarshan. And Vishnu said, I can't. You have to go to Ambarish and you have to ask him for forgiveness. Then immediately he ran back again towards. So he might have got to Vaikuntha, but he did not get in Vaikuntha consciousness. And that's why he couldn't stay there. So sometimes we may have this oversimplified conception of the spiritual world. And for the purpose of depicting, say in the Bhagavatam first canto, we have that depiction that, okay, this is the material world and this is the spiritual world. So when we have that kind of depiction, we might think that, okay, it's almost like, say, if you're on the world map, this is America and this is Canada, or the world, this is India and this is China. So they are like in geographical continuity. So you go from here to here and you get from one country to another country. But the material world and the spiritual world, they are not like a geographical continuity. In fact, material geography, that concept itself, does not apply to the spiritual world. So although for the sake of depiction, we might say the material world is here and the spiritual world is there, but the spiritual world and material world, they are not like two levels in a building, lower level, higher level. The spiritual world exists at a different level of reality. And so to get there, it is not just relocation that is required. It is transformation. It's not just physically going from this place to another place, but it's rather transformation of consciousness that is required. And only by the transformation of consciousness, one can go to the spiritual world. So now, if we consider this point of eligibility, that a devotee, by the practice of bhakti, tries to direct the thoughts and the consciousness toward Krishna, tries to live a life devoted toward Krishna. So when I said we are never qualified, but we are never disqualified either. Also. We are always unqualified. Unqualified in the sense that nobody can claim I am so pure that I can attain Vaikuntha. That Krishna has to get me into Vaikuntha. Nobody can claim that level of purity. But we are never disqualified. In the sense that Krishna will never say that you are so fallen that you can't practice bhakti only. So each one of us has the potential to attain divinity, to attain the spiritual world. So there is the potential, and there is now the potential has to be developed. So for example, in Prabhupada says, Nitya Siddha Krishna Prem Sadhya Kabunai Shravan Adi Shuddha Chitta Karaya Uday. So that love for Krishna is present in everyone's heart. Nitya Siddha Krishna Prem Sadhya Kabunai. What does it mean? There are different ways of understanding this. Now, Sanskrit, it's very difficult to translate into English. So sometimes we just have to use the approximate words. So now those words might have slightly different connotations also. Say for example, there is the concept of avatar. Now, how is that translated in English? What is the word for avatar?
Incarnation.
Now, if you consider literally speaking, thank you. Literally speaking, incarnation, what it means is karna, is like carnivorous animals or carnal desires. It refers to flesh. So, incarnation literally means to come in flesh. And the word incarnation comes primarily from Christianity, where the divinity of Christ is said to manifest in the humanity of Jesus. So, they consider Jesus to be both God and human, God and man. And so now Jesus came in a physical body, and that's how he was crucified and everything that happened. So that the term incarnation itself is something which is come from a Western theological context. And avatar, one of the tenets of the Vaishnava understanding is that when God comes to the material world, he does not come in a material form. So incarnation, when that word is used, that might give that notion that actually that the Lord has come in a material body. Now, Prabhupada uses that word incarnation, but then he clarifies that actually the Lord doesn't come in a material body. Now, of course, we can say the word incarnation also has a secondary meaning. It also has the incarnation of this idea, the incarnation of the spirit of the country, something like that. But that's a very secondary use. The primary use of incarnation is we have reincarnation, to come again in flesh. So why I'm making this point is that when we talk about love for Krishna, so Prabhupada uses the word dormancy over there, that love for Krishna is dormant in everyone's hearts, and by the process of hearing and chanting, it will be activated. So this dormancy is not literally in the sense of just we are asleep and we wake up and everything is there. It is like yesterday we had the example of a dream. So we are talking about how the pure devotee understand, or the spiritually realized person understand that this world is like a dream. And now this dream metaphor is something which has to be carefully understood. Like sometimes some devotees say that once a devotee gave a class. I was in a temple. A devotee gave a class how death can come at any moment. And in fact, he showed a video, and on YouTube you can find videos of how there are like almost like 25 clippings of people doing normal activities and they die. Say somebody is in a shopping mall and offers the cash to someone and suddenly they get a heart attack and they die. And somebody is driving a bike and while driving a bike they get a stroke. And they die and the bike runs over someone and they also die. So it's like horrible scenes. And then his point was that death can come at any moment. And then after that, one devotee asked that, he said we should always remember that death can come at any moment, that we may die today, we may die the next moment. So then this devotee asked the question, he says, Prabhu, if I start thinking that I will die today or die at the next moment, then I don't feel like I should go for a job. I won't feel like taking care of my child. I won't feel like doing any of my family responsibilities. And that's the point. Nothing needs to be done. Now, that's not exactly the point. Okay, I'm going to die. So what do? I live constantly in fear of death? No, okay, the understanding that I'm going to die, what should it lead to? It should lead to an awareness that there are important things and there are less important things. And I need to focus on the most important things. So death will come, and it is not just by giving up our job or giving up our family responsibilities or whatever, we will be able to deal with death. It is we have to cultivate absorption in Krishna. And we should not neglect the process of cultivating absorption in Krishna to later time. Now, how exactly we cultivate absorption to Krishna? Not everybody, even if they are given full time and opportunity, they can say constantly chant 64 rounds or 128 rounds. Everybody has to find out how they can progress towards absorption in Krishna. And again, that I'll discuss in the last class, that progressive level of practice. But the important thing is that we can't take a philosophical concept and apply it arbitrarily. So, okay, this is like a death can come at any moment, but there is a process to transcend this. And the awareness that death can come at any moment, that should make us urgent in practicing the process of absorption in Krishna who exists beyond death. Not that we just give up everything in the material world because of the fear of death. So, similarly, the world is a dream. But this is a normal dream, you just shake someone and the person wakes up. But for us, to wake up from this dream, it requires a process. And we need to follow the process by which we will awaken to higher reality. So similarly, when it is said that it is dormant. So dormancy is more in the sense of fertility. It's like the soil is fertile. The soil of our heart, of the soul's consciousness is fertile. But in that fertile soil, it's not that the fertile soil innately will itself develop crops. In the fertile soil, seeds have to be put. Seeds have to be sown and then the crops will grow. So similarly, in our heart, in our consciousness, Brahmanda Brahmite Kona Bhagyavan Jeev, Guru Krishna Prasade Pai Bhakti Lata Beej. So Bhakti Lata Beej. The seed of the creeper of devotion has to be planted by the mercy of Guru and Krishna. And then that can grow. So in one sense, we are all eligible because the soul has the potential for developing love of God. So in that sense, we are never disqualified. Even if somebody is born in a very degraded family, somebody has lived a very degraded life, no matter how fallen they are, the soul has the potential for manifesting its divinity. So in that sense, we are never disqualified. But it's not that we are ever qualified enough. So the eligibility is that, so at one level, just by being parts of Krishna, we all have eligibility to practice the process that will take us back to Godhead. So if somebody for immigration doesn't have the eligibility criteria itself, then their application itself will not be considered. But just because your application is considered, that doesn't mean you are going to get into the country. So when we are talking about eligibility, it's like, is our application considered? Yes. Nobody, no matter how many wrong things they have done, it's not that they are ineligible for the practice of bhakti. In that sense, bhakti is universal. Krishna does not reject anyone. Dhruva, at one level, started the process of bhakti out of, we could say, materialistic purpose. It was all material emotions. He had been insulted, he wanted vengeance. But doesn't matter. Yena kena prakarena mana Krishna niveshayet. Somehow or the other, fix the mind in Krishna. So we are eligible always. Because just by being parts of Krishna, just by being souls, the potential for pure devotion, the potential for manifesting our divinity and attaining the supreme divinity are there within us. But along with that, once we start getting into the practice, what does it mean that we are never, we are always unqualified. We are not disqualified, but we are unqualified. That means nothing that we do can oblige Krishna to take us back to him. Why is it like that? Because Krishna's mercy is causeless. Now, what does causeless mercy mean? Does it mean it has no cause? Well, yes and no. That means that it is not dependent on the cause. So Prabhupada gave an example that once he was on a morning walk, and while on the walk he saw a man, he was by a pond, and he was throwing some food crumbles at some ducks who were in the pond. Of course, nowadays it seems that people are told if there are ponds and the ducks, don't feed the ducks because the food may be contaminated and the ducks may die. So probably things were not so regulated 40-50 years ago. But so what happened is that now these ducks were coming and quacking, quack, quack, quack. And when they're quacking at that time, there was one duck which is quacking a lot. And this man was throwing a little more food crumbs at that duck. So the Prabhupada said, this is how we should call for Krishna's mercy. That if we call out desperately for Krishna's mercy, if we call out more, Krishna will give us more mercy. Now, it is not that the person's calling out itself, that the ducks quacking oblige the person to give that mercy, and give that extra mercy. The person is completely independent. But the quacking is the way the duck expresses the desire. And then the person is free to reciprocate. So we can't say that, oh, I fasted on Nirjal Ekadashi. Nirjal, Krishna, give me mercy. We can't do like that. But by our endeavors, we try to call out to Krishna. And then Krishna is free to reciprocate. In the Bible, there is a nice story which illustrates this principle of causeless grace. That there was a man and he was going in a marketplace early in the morning, and he saw that there are many people who were just standing there. And they were looking very destitute. He said, what happened? He says, you know, we lost our jobs, we don't have any money. So he said, come to my field and you work all day, I will pay you. And then all of them came and they started working on the field. And then this man came later in the afternoon, around lunchtime, and he again was going through the marketplace, and again he saw many more people over there. And then he saw those people, what happened? He said, oh, we don't have any money. Okay, come to my field, I will pay you. We work for the field and I will pay you. And then the evening came, and when the evening came, at that time, what happened? This landlord, paid everyone. And those who were working from morning to evening, and those who were working from afternoon to evening, he paid all of them equally. And actually, what happened? What do you think happened? Yeah, those who had been paid from that worked from morning, they said, hey, but we worked more. Why are you paying them the same amount? He said that you were jobless. You were getting nothing. And I have given you what I promised to give you. Now, if I give someone else, what does that got to do with you? Now, today's labor laws, we say it's unfair practice. But the point is, he was illustrating that God's grace does not depend on the magnitude of our endeavor. So sometimes we might do a lot of service and we might get some grace, and somebody might do a little service and they might also get grace. And we see this variability of the grace in the sense that in a few verses later it will describe that Dhruva Maharaj's mother also goes back to Godhead. Now it was at one level we can say it was because Dhruva remembered the Lord, remembered his mother gratefully, and that's why the Lord arranged for his mother also to be taken back to Godhead. That's true. But if somebody wants to be like an argumentative person, they say that, okay, Dhruva performed austerities. Dhruva went to the forest. What did his mother do? Apart from just being related to him and guiding him. The Lord's grace is reciprocal, but it is not necessarily proportional. Reciprocal, we have to do something. If the Lord will not force us to come to him. He will not take away our free will and forcibly drag us back to Godhead. So we have to take some steps towards him. So his mercy is reciprocal, but it is not necessarily proportional. So somebody might do a lot and they will get the Lord's mercy. Some might be do a little and they might also get the Lord's mercy. So our eligibility is not what determines whether we get go back to Godhead. Our eligibility simply starts the process. And how that process works and how we can make it work in our life, we'll discuss in a future class. So I'll summarize. I spoke today on this theme of the eligibility for going back to Godhead. So we see that Dhruva is so eminently eligible that the Vishnudutas are coming personally to escort him. It is like the government of a prosperous country personally sending its emissaries, please come to our country. He must be a very special person. So I talked about how normally souls who are outside the normal spectrum, who are both extremes, those who are very grievous wrongdoers, they will be escorted by the Yamdutas. And those who are glorious right doers, we could say, they will be escorted by the Vishnudutas. And most will be in between, they will go unescorted. And I talk about this personal vision of higher beings is special. And that I talked about the past time of Dhruva, of Prithu Maharaj. And just the yagya being performed is success. Just yagya being performed and devatas becoming visible is the greatest success. Yagyas being performed and Vishnu becoming visible is the greatest success. So Prithu got the greatest success because he was right beyond right. That means he did not let the right action come in the way of the right purpose. So rather than pointing out that somebody is wrong in a class, we maintain the mood civility of the class, and that way that's the right purpose is maintained. So I talked about the point of what was the eligibility of Dhruva. Talked about, you can say Dhruva had a, you could say he did not start with, was not born a pure devotee. If you look from the narrative as an evolutionary narrative of Dhruva's consciousness, and he was motivated by material desires, and later on also he succumbed to some material anger, but still by the end of his life he was ready, because he lived a life of devotion to the Lord. So what was his eligibility? His eligibility was that we could say at one level, he was devoted to the Lord throughout. And I talked about how eligibility, so who has the eligibility? Everyone. Because just by being souls who are parts of the divine, each one of us has the potential to manifest, to attain Krishna. And so I talked about the difference between eligibility and, you could say, if you want to use the word qualification in that sense, that eligibility means we are allowed to participate. Qualified means we are allowed to enter into the final thing. So we are never qualified in the sense that, that means none of us can barge into the kingdom of God. So, but at the same time, we are never disqualified also, in the sense that no matter how fallen we are, the Lord always gives us the opportunity to come to Him. And there I talked about Nitya Siddha Krishna Prem. So that is dormancy, but the dormancy is more in the sense of fertility. But there is a process to be followed for that potential for pure devotion to be manifest in us. I talk about how words need to be carefully understood. That just like somebody says, I'm going to die, that doesn't mean you just leave everything. So that life is just a dream. That doesn't mean we just can wake up. There's a process for transcending that. There's a process for waking up. And it's commitment to the process that is required. And I conclude by talking about the Lord's grace is reciprocal, but not necessarily proportional. So, I just said the ducks quacking inspired the person to give more food crumbs, but not obliged to do that. So, they said the person may pay a person who does half work, day work and full day work also the same. That's the nature of the causeless grace of the Lord. So, we don't question the Lord's grace, but we beseech the Lord's grace. And how we can beseech that grace, we'll talk in the next session on Sunday. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Any question or comment? Yes, Mataji.
Prabhu, could you please explain a little bit more what happens to the souls lying in between at the time of their death? So if someone is practicing sadhaka, has not been
So what happens in between to the souls who are not yet purified. Basically, this is a quite a gray zone. In the scriptures, it's not very clearly described, and it cannot be also, because each soul has its own karma, and each soul has to go through its own trajectory of spiritual evolution. But broadly speaking, we could say that if the soul is devoted to the Lord, ultimately the Lord will not do anything that will interrupt our spiritual journey. So Krishna gives two possible trajectories in the sixth chapter. He says, if somebody has a lot of material desires still remaining, and they are practicing bhakti also, then they will be taken to heavens, where they can indulge in their material desires within a pious context, religious context, and then then after that they come back to this world and they continue in a pious family or a wealthy family. The others, if they are already very spiritually strong and they don't have material desires so much, then they will be born in a family where they will get spiritual environment and they will grow from there. So those two are the broad trajectories, but essentially the principle is that the soul will never lose the opportunity to practice devotion. Prabhupada also said that. So these two are both, you know, are trajectories of person who has not attained pure devotion, but not that the person has grievous wrongdoings. So if a person does, while practicing bhakti, somehow does repeatedly grievous wrongdoings, and Prabhupada said that those who are born as animals, maybe hogs or something like that in Vrindavan, they are also great spiritual people. The hogs are also spiritual, but he said they did something wrong, and that's why they were born in that. They're born in an exalted place, but in a lower body. So that can also happen. Aho bhatashopachoto gariyan ya jivvagre vartate namatubhyam. So it says that in the fourth canto, it is said that if somebody is low born, but they are chanting your holy names, that means that they must have already done piety in the previous life. Now you might say, the question might come, if they have already done piety in the previous life, why are they low born? Isn't it? So the point of that verse is that sometimes somebody might have lived a life of piety, but then they might have also done something terribly wrong. So we could say that there are two different things over here. There is the material law of karma, and there is the spiritual principle of grace. And these two both will work. It's not that the material law of karma will not work. I say, even if somebody is a pure devotee, and they are chanting, and they are remembering Krishna, but they are absent-minded, and they come to the edge of a big wall or a big building, and they step off. Now, just because they are pure devotee doesn't mean the law of gravity will not act, isn't it? It will act. So similarly, because the law of karma is like that, and we see this demonstrated, both these dynamics demonstrated in the Jadabharat pastime, Bharat Maharaj pastime rather. So because he had a spiritual attraction toward the Lord, so he never, if we have strived to practice bhakti, the opportunity to practice bhakti will not be taken away from us. But because he had become attached to a deer, so at the material level, because his consciousness was directed over there, so he got the body of a deer. So at the material level, the law of last thought, whatever we think about at the time of that, that's what we will attain, that applied. But at spiritual level, neha bhikramana shosti, what consciousness we have cultivated toward Krishna, that is never lost. So how were the two reconciled? That was through the fact that Bharat Maharaj got a deer's body, but he did not get deer's consciousness. Within the deer body, he had the consciousness of not just a human consciousness, but advanced human consciousness. So he was also very spiritually inclined, even in the deer body. So how exactly things will be reconciled, that the super soul will direct based on our consciousness and our karma. But broadly, we can be sure that the opportunity for practicing spiritual life will never be lost. So thank you very much. Grantra, please prove.
You said the Lord's mercy is reciprocal but not
necessarily proportional.
Then how do we understand the Krishna statement of the Etamam Prapatam Bhagavatam Bhajamyaham?
Yes, that's true. Actually, Yethamam Prapadyanitam Satay Bhajamyaham is talking about the reciprocity. That's reciprocal. I reciprocate accordingly. But is the reciprocity proportional? We see that if we consider the example that Ajamil, he lived a terribly wrong life, but still we can say that just by chanting one name of Narayan, he was saved from the Yamapasha. Conversely, we have the example of Haridas, Chota Haridas. He lived a life of virtue, but one mistake, and he was grievously punished for that. So now, it was not that the Lord rejected Chota Haridas. Although externally it appeared like that, but Chota Haridas, whatever body he came in, people thought it was a ghostly body because they couldn't see it. But actually, he was chanting the names of the Lord, and he was pleasing the Lord by that. So basically, although he ended his body, it was not that he became a ghost. He attained a higher destination through that. So sometimes the Lord might, to make an example, take a small mistake and give a severe reaction to that. And sometimes a big mistake also, there might be no result of that. Or a small right thing, there might be a big positive result of that. So if we consider the principle that the Lord is independent, so then he deals with every soul in a way that is the best for that soul's evolution. But it's not necessarily proportional that I have done this much, that's why you have to give me this much. In fact, the Vishnu Sahasranam says that Gurur Guru Tamo Dhamma Nimisho Nimisha Swagri Vachas Patirudaradhi. So Nimisha and Animisha. Nimisha means the one who blinks his eyes. Animisha is one who never blinks his eyes. So what Baldev Vidyabhushan explains in his commentary on the Vishnu Sahasranam is that this refers to that if the devotee does something wrong, then the Lord blinks his eyes and overlooks the wrong. But if the devotee does something right, devotee does even the smallest service, the Lord unblinkingly keeps his eyes open and notices and rewards that service. So the example is of Putana. Putana came with a malicious attitude to kill Krishna. But because she offered her milk, what did Krishna do? Krishna closed his eyes. And at a material level, she got the result that she had to be separated, her soul had to be separated from that sinful body that she was in. But she was made the Aho Bakiyam Stanaka Lakutam. She was made into the Dhatri of the nurse of Krishna. So that's not all. Where is the proportion in that? There are sages and seekers who lifetime practice sadhana. And Putana just comes once and offers not even milk, he offers poison. So Krishna's grace is not proportional. It's reciprocal. Krishna saw that small spark of the desire to serve. Actually, the acharya has explained that in the previous life, she was Krutamala, the sister of Bali Maharaj. And when she saw Vamana, this small field was nice boy, attractive boy coming over there. Then she was attracted. Oh, this is such a nice boy. I said, nice child. I wish he was mine. And I would have taken care of him. But when he turned and took away everything from Bali Maharaj, she got angry with him. So in her next life, that desire for service was there, but also the anger was there. So she became Putana. So we see that in the case of Putana's liberation, it's definitely not it's not proportional. So, yethamam prapadyante is the principle of reciprocity, but it is not necessarily the proportional principle of proportionality. Proportionality is the Lord is, see, there is the Lord's fairness and the Lord's mercifulness. So, mercy is not bound by rules, and proportionality means it is bound by rules. Now, we could say that if we take one step towards the Lord takes 1,000 steps towards us. Now, that is reciprocal, but is it proportional? It's not exactly proportional because, you know, it's only one step from us, 1,000 steps from him. Now, how much is one step from us, how much 1,000 steps from him? We don't know. We say that for him, 3 steps can span the whole universe also. So, 1,000 steps would span such a big distance. So, he's reciprocal. So, yethamam prapadyante talks about reciprocity. But if you look at other instances where sometimes this for a small mistake, a big punishment can be given. Then that's, or for a small good thing, a big reward can be given. Then we don't see the exactly proportionality over there. Prabhupada also gives the example of how mother-in-law may teach by the daughter-in-law by chastising the daughter. That the daughter-in-law is not serving the food properly. And because the daughter-in-law is new, the mother-in-law doesn't criticize the daughter-in-law. He just criticizes the daughter, hey, why are you doing like this? Now, she is not actually doing like that. But she is used as an instrument by which the daughter will look, oh, I am not meant to do like this, I should do like this. So that is how sometimes a devotee may not have done anything wrong, but the Lord may use the devotee, and the devotee may go through some difficulties so that others will learn how to deal with difficulties. So in that sense, the Lord is reciprocal but not necessarily proportional. Does that address your question, Bhu? Anything else? Okay. Can you talk one to one after the class? So thank you very much. Gantra Srimad Bhagavatam ki, Shrila Prabhupada ki, Gaur Bhaktavrinda ki, Gaur Premanande.